Well, welcome back to Redeemed by Grace Fellowship. I hope you've had a good week. I know that I have. It's been an exciting one and an interesting one at the same time, if you know how those weeks go. But I hope you have. I hope you've got a chance to take a look at our lesson for today, because we are going to continue in our study of the Pauline epistles, specifically looking at 2 Corinthians in chapter 6, all 18 verses of that chapter. I know some of you had a chance because you emailed over a few questions that we will try and answer as we go through this lesson today. But if you have questions that come up and you haven't sent them ahead of time, that's okay. You can still send them over on email. Yes, we don't have a comment section in live chat because some of you have some things you need to talk about that are private. And so thus we use email for that. And you can reach us at any time at rbgf22@yahoo.com. rbgf22@yahoo.com. So if you have questions that you're unsure of as you're preparing for your lesson, or questions that come up after the lesson, or you have needs for prayer, or you have needs for celebrating something that God's done in your life, or maybe you have some issues that you need counseling with, whatever it might be, rbgf22@yahoo.com. Feel free to get a hold of us and we will have a conversation and pray together and see what we can do to help you out in any of those situations. So one thing I am going to ask you to do is to please make sure that you do help us proclaim the gospel around the world. And you can do that best with this fellowship by making sure that you're subscribed to all our platforms, because there's content on each one of those that is important that you not only like, because the algorithm all runs off of that, and that algorithm tells that platform to keep sending it out to more and more people. And so the more that you hit that, the more this gets sent out across the world, and more folks get to learn about Jesus Christ. And that's important. And so make sure that you do that. Specifically, you will find our videos on YouTube and Rumble. You will sometimes find it on Facebook as well. If not, there'll be a link on Facebook for that. But a lot of our written content will be, that content will be found on Facebook as well. And so you want to make sure you do that as well. But again, you're going to find this audio on of these lessons on Spotify and some others that we're looking at. We'll announce as we get closer to opening those up. Right now, we're just trying them out, see how they work. Of course, there's Twitter/X, whichever you want to call it. I have a hard time switching, but it is called X now. And Instagram, TikTok. You'll find us on True Social, LinkedIn, as well as Threads. And you'll see some of our pictures also out there on Pinterest. So feel free to go to any and all of those and make sure that you're subscribed so that you never miss out on any of our content. So let's go ahead and open up in prayer, and then we will get started by listening to the Word of God read to us. So let's pray. Almighty God, we're just so thankful that we can gather together again to get with you, to spend time with you, Lord, to open up your Word. I pray, Lord, that you would clear our minds and hearts to the clutter of life, that we might hear you speak directly to us, to let us know what it is that you would have us do with your Word, to apply it to our lives. Sometimes our minds go off and hear these things and we think, well, that was important for those guys, but it don't mean anything to me. Well, we know that's not true. That's the power of your Word. And so we pray, Lord, that you would open our minds and hearts to receive it and to believe it. And so, Lord, we thank you for that. Continue to pray for the fellowship, Lord, as we thank you for the growth that you have given us. We're awestruck by it. And Lord, we just put it in your hands and pray that you would continue to do that, that more people will learn about Jesus Christ and more people will plug into their very local church as well as a result. So we thank you for that, Lord. But I do want to lift up our brother in Pakistan, Ashir, who is continued to work with the orphanage and those kids there that are in big need of food right now. It's an issue, Lord, that you know about. You know the persecution is real and happening there. You know that the 13 churches have been burned down in the city where Ashir is alone, and his has been threatened. And so, Lord, we just pray for his protection and the children's protection. But, Lord, we ask most of all that you would not only provide food for those kids, but that, Lord, you would reveal yourself to them and provide salvation for them as well. And we thank you for that. And we lift this prayer in the only name that we can, and that is the precious and holy name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And amen, and amen. Well, folks, if you are interested in helping Ashir, send me an email at rbgf22@yahoo.com, and I'll let you know exactly how you could directly help him out with that quest to come up with food. So for those kids. So absolutely, rbgf22@yahoo.com will get you the information that you need. So, as always, we're going to listen to the Word of God read to us. Some people ask still, why do we do that? Can't you just read it? Well, I could. That's not a problem. I'm actually going to reread it to you during the course of the lesson. But the thing is, just demonstrate some technology that's out there. There's many apps out there that you can utilize to supplement your studies, and one of those, three of those, in fact, I'm going to talk about right now that I totally recommend. One's Gateway Bible, the other is Blue Letter Bible, which we're going to utilize today, and the third one is the Gideon's Bible app. All of those are free. You can download them on any device that you'd like to. So you just go out, download it. They will give you study material that help you with that, from commentaries to dictionaries to coordinates to whatever it is you might need at the click of a mouse or swipe of a finger. You can have that content right before you. You can also look at multiple translations at the same time, including Greek and Hebrew, if you can read that. And so those are very positive things. But one of the things they also give us is the ability to have audio. And why yet is that important, you ask? Well, quite frankly, there's times in the course of a day, I know it happens to me, so it's got to happen to you, where life is just chaotic and busy. And there's times that I spend time studying my scripture in the morning, and yet there's times that I'm really got my mind thinking about the things I got to get done today, and I got to hurry up with this and get on with kind of thing. And so there's times like that. We all experience them. And it's nice to know when I've got a good drive to get to where I'm going in first in the morning, that I can pop it in my ear and listen to it read to me and go back through what I just spent time in studying and go, wow, I missed that. Or, wow, I hear it even better now. And I need to check it out a little bit more right there. And so those things happen. You know, you could be out in the yard doing something. You could be doing something in the house that you've got to get done. And so all those things are there. And again, so utilize those. Download them. Again, yeah, Gateway Bible, Blue Letter Bible, or the Gideon's Bible app. And we're going to use Blue Letter. And so I'm going to cue that in right now. And let's listen to chapter 6 read to us. And here we go.
Chapter 6. Working together with him, then, we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, in a favorable time I listened to you, and in a day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We put no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry, but as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, by great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, the Holy Spirit, genuine love, by truthful speech and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, through honor and dishonor, through slander and praise. We are treated as impostors, and yet are true, as unknown, and yet well known, as dying, and behold, we live, as punished, and yet not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, yet possessing everything. We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted in your own affections. In return, I speak as to children, widen your hearts also. Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? What accord has Christ with Belial? Or what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God said, I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore go out from their midst and be separate from them, says the Lord, and touch no unclean thing. Then I will welcome you, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty.
All right. All right. So that's a nice thing to have, a nice tool to have, is these Bible apps in which they might be able to read to you the scripture. Because you hear a lot of things when those are read to you. Now, we'll talk a little bit about where we've been, where we're going, and where we are as we go through that. As we started this letter, we obviously started with an introduction in which we set the background a little bit using the letter of Acts, which we also did for the first letter going to the Corinthians, to find out a little bit about how, why this church was planted there, what was going on behind the scenes, and so on and so forth. And so as this letter started, we looked at Paul's greeting. That's a unique way that he begins each and every one of his letters. And there's a lot of theology in there. There's a lot of good meat in that greeting as we look at it that we can get in and chew on and see indeed what he is doing. And so since the first chapter, he's been on this narrative about talking about his ministry. And he's been breaking it down in several segments as he's going through and talking about the importance of that. And why is he doing that, you might ask? Well, if you remember, these false prophets that have come up in the church in Corinth, while Paul's been away up in Ephesus doing some work with the church there, and Paul knows that some things are going on there from the reports he's getting from the men he left back there in charge, if you will. And so he's getting this information, and he's concerned about it. In fact, some of the divisions that were happening within the church itself wrote a letter to Paul and with some questions. What about this? What about that? What do we do about these things? And Paul, through the first letter, he answered each one of those things. And he also then not only gave encouragement to stand firm, but what to do about the situation going on there. So he's talked a lot about it. He started off by talking about some of his plans that he's planning to return to Corinth in the near future. But right now he is detained, if you will, in Ephesus, and the door is open for the gospel there. So he needs to hang tight. But he sends again at first, then it's Timothy he sends down there. And then second, he sends Titus to get a report of how did they receive that first letter and what's going on there. And so he talked about the offenders, the ones that, what to do about these people, how to punish them, or whatever needs to be done about these people that are continually offending and trying to bust up the church. And so he talks a little bit about that. He talks about Titus's absence and why he's been gone from there, and now that he's heading back, and the weight that Paul is going through as he's waiting for him to return, and how that's affecting him, not only in his ministry, which it did tremendously affect him, but also his own health. I mean, he is really, really depressed the fact that Titus had made it back yet. So what's going on, type of thing. It's nice when we have email and social media and stuff like that in today's world to get instant communication, but you know, it'd take a while on foot or to walk all the way from the Peloponnese, where Corinth is, in Achaia, all the way up through Athens, all the way up into Macedonia, all the way then up to where he can cross over into Asia, where Ephesus is. That's a long walk. Takes a while. So but anyway, he talks about his ministry's nature, and he's still on that a little bit through the end of this chapter. And so he's going to talk about that, and so far he's already covered the triumph of it, the condemnation of the ministry, the basis of it, the theme of this ministry, and the trials that occur because of it, and the motivation behind it, all of which are things that the false prophets back there were attacking in Paul's character and what he was actually trying to do with the ministry, which were all lies, of course, but nevertheless, there were people that were concerned about it in the church, of course. And then we moved into this message of the ministry, and now we're hitting the idea where he's going to talk about the conduct of the ministry. What should a faithful servant of God, what should their conduct be like? What is that all about? And then he begins to change that to exhorting them, to encouraging them, to open their hearts to him, as well as to separate themselves from unbelievers who could tear them apart. And he's going to finish off that he's going to be reassured in the next chapter about his love for them. He's going to then move to this collection that he has been taking up. And what has occurred is that back in Judea, in Jerusalem, there is a mass famine going on. And it's been going on for a while, and the people are really suffering as a result of it back there. And so he has taken up this collection in Asia, in Macedonia, and of course down in Achaia as well, with Corinth, the church at Corinth. And so the questions have come up about that. What is this? And that's a common question in today's world, because you see certain preachers, there's people out there say, well, they're just all about money, 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 money. And unfortunately, there are false prophets that actually do that. And it smears the ministry of the good and faithful servant of the Lord. And Paul is one of those. And so he begins to talk about, well, let's talk about giving. What are the patterns of it? What are the patterns that the Macedonians have been using? What is the pattern that Jesus Christ himself had? What's the purpose of it? What's the procedure? What's that look like? and what's the promise of this giving? And then he's going to finish off talking about his apostleship, because that's another area in which these false prophets are attacking his apostleship. And so he's going to talk about what is the authority of that position, what is the conduct expected of that position, what type of suffering does that person have to go through, and what are the credentials of it. So he's going to lay it all out so that they have a good understanding of what it really is, instead of just hearing what the false prophets have to say. And then he's going to talk about this visit that he is trying to get back, his unselfishness in getting there, the warnings that he has for them before he gets back, and of course his benediction. And we talked about how important his greeting was at the beginning. His benediction is found in the same way there. So that's kind of where we've been, where we're going, and where we are in a nutshell. And so let's get into it and begin to break this down and take a look at it and see what it all means. And as we go through it, we'll answer some of your questions that you guys sent in. Try to fit them in where appropriate. And once again, if I don't answer your question, feel free to send the email back and say, hey, that wasn't satisfactory enough. I still don't understand. How about this? And we'll try and sort that out for you. So 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 and 2 read, working together with him, then we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, I are in a favorable time, I listen to you, and in a day of salvation, I have helped you. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Well, if God made his appeal to the people through Paul, there was kind of a sense in which Paul was a fellow worker with God, which would make total sense, right? As such, he was concerned, very concerned, to plead God's cause with unbelievers and believers alike. And hence he was urging, addressed to the whole body, body of Christians at Corinth in this letter, not to receive God's grace in vain. I mean, the latter phrase may mean one of two things. Either A, Paul doesn't want the Corinthians to show by their present lives that they had received God's grace to no purpose, and B, that Paul doesn't want the Corinthians to spurn the grace of God, which had been perpetually offered to them. And I mean, how could they fail to profit from that grace, right? And so by refusing to purify themselves from everything that contaminated the body and spirit, and by allowing a chasm to develop between faith and conduct, or by embracing a different gospel based on observing the law as the ground acceptance of God, most of the Corinthians were saved, but hindered by the legalistic teaching regarding sanctification. And so some weren't truly saved, but deceived by a gospel of works. My friends, it's no different today, right? Gospel of works. And what does that do? It was being taught by these false teachers, and it basically countered anything that the actual gospel. We call them the Judaizers, and basically you're looking at people that says, okay, all that Jesus stuff is good, but to really have this super spirituality with God, you also need to then observe the laws of Moses. You need to understand the laws that Judaism provides. And so you need to do these things plus Christ. and are more likely not plus Christ, but you need to do these things for salvation. And any of that Christ stuff is good to add on. It's just like, you know, the topping of the cake or something, the icing on the cake. But in either case, Paul's proclamation of the gospel of grace, it wouldn't have been having its desired effect, and he would have had to cause for a serious concern, which he did, that his many months of ministry at Corinth were for nothing, because sometimes that's exactly what he felt like. If you're in ministry today, you understand exactly what that feeling is like. But in both cases, were also prevented the people from effectively assuming any ministry of reconciliation, which is an important thing. Well, the first question that was sent over says, how can God's grace be in vain? Awesome question, and thank you for sending that over. And again, if you have a question like this as you're preparing, rbgf22@yahoo.com, send it over and we will try and get it on here. If I don't receive it in time by the time we're preparing this lesson, then I'll probably shoot you the email back with the answer there. So understand this, first of all. Again, how can God's grace be in vain? Well, God's grace is never futile. It never is futile, but it can be misused. So understand that. If we claim to believe the gospel, but never demonstrate its effects on our lives, what good has it done? And if we continue to live for ourselves rather than fulfill God's purpose, then we have received God's grace in vain, and our faith was evidently not genuine. And the result is effectively the same as it would have been had we never heard the gospel. In other words, you're still lost. And my friend, I hate to tell you this, but there is some statistics that are put out by the common denominations that are in America. And I could tell you that they state that 80% of people in their churches who profess to be Christians are not genuine and therefore are still lost and still heading to hell. That is horrifying. But that is what he's kind of addressing here with some of these people that are in the church. And the result is effectively the same as it would have been had they never heard the gospel, he says. If we squander God's marvelous gift to us or receive his grace in vain by failing to draw upon his power to live in a godly way, and persisting in our sinfulness by continuing to try to earn salvation that was given to us freely, or by shifting our allegiance away from the Lord because of false teachers. I mean, to emphasize the seriousness and urgency of his appeal here, and to highlight the privilege of the present and danger of procrastination, Paul quotes Old Testament here, Isaiah chapter 49 and verse 8. You might take a chance when we get done with this lesson to go check it out. But Isaiah 49 and 8 that he will use, and then he applies the passage to the age of grace. I mean, in its original context, this quotation belongs to a section of Isaiah where the Lord directly addresses his servant who had been despised and abhorred by the nation. Whole country was after him, and promising him vindication before the people in due time, and calling on him to carry out the work of restoration after the return from exile. That's a time where the Babylonians come in and they haul off Israel and Judea to Babylon. Paul uses, the quotation here to establish that the gospel era, which is right now, folks, we're still in it, is the day of salvation. And when God's favor is shown to humankind, how unthinkable that such grace should be received in vain. It never makes sense to put off a decision to accept God's offer of salvation. How many have waited too long? How would anyone want to delay the joy that comes through the vital relationship with the Lord? When he calls, he wants immediate obedience. Today's the day to respond. It really is. Let's look at the next two verses, or three verses, verses 3-5. We put no obstacle in anyone's way so that no fault may be found in our ministry. But as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way by great assurance in afflictions, hardships, calamities, if I can read, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger. Well, let's stop there. That list is quite lengthy and it's going to continue. But let's look at those real quick. Well, like Paul, any believer who engages in unfaithful ministry of reconciliation should expect to be rejected and accepted, to be hated and loved, to encounter joy and hardship. And Jesus had already taught this to his disciples. And one of the greatest obstacles to the progress of the gospel is the bad example of people who profess to be Christians. Unsaved people like to use the inconsistencies of the saints, especially preachers, as an excuse for rejecting Jesus Christ. And Paul was careful not to do anything that would put a stumbling block in the way of either sinners or saints. He didn't want the ministry to be blamed in any way because of his life. We see that all the time, don't we? In today's world, we're all sinners. We're going to continue to sin. We profess all this Christ, and then all of a sudden, we slip up and do something, and there they are. Woohoo! Aha! You hypocrite! You call yourself a Christian, but you know what I'm saying? And so Paul's concerned about that, and that's one thing we need to be sure of in our own lives, in this strive for holiness and dealing with sin and repentance, that we too look at those things in our lives, pray to get them removed, that God would remove them from our hearts, and do everything in our power not to put ourselves in a position in which somebody can point the finger and go, aha, aha. Now, as was fitting for an ambassador for Christ, Paul tried to put, again, no stumbling block in anyone's path, lest the ministry would surely incur discredit. And the various accusations that were being leveled against Paul were inevitable. Given the success of his ministry and the jealousy of others, his concern was that such charges would be totally without foundation, that no minister of reconciliation be guilty or inconsistent of dishonest conduct, and that no handle be given adversaries who wish to ridicule or malign the gospel. I mean, the life of the Christian minister is the most eloquent advertisement for the gospel. No pressure. But that's the truth, right? Well, Paul, he proceeds to itemize his hardships as he seeks to commend and defend the ministry as a servant of God and to provide the Corinthians with, you know, further material that they may might use in his defense. And Paul's commendation was a matter of actions, not of words. A reference letter, if you will, to the great endurance that marked all of his service in suffering. In fact, Paul lists for us 9 afflictions, which really kind of fall into 3 groups. The general trials, which were the troubles that are oppressive experiences and hardships that refer to the unrevealed adverse circumstances and distresses that are frustrating, tight corners, if you will. Or the second thing being the sufferings directly inflicted by others. I mean, the beatings and the imprisonments and the riots, all that we've talked about that Paul's endured so far, and he's got a lot more. I mean, at his conversion, the gentleman that came in with the gospel to him when he was struck down blind by God, told him he was going to suffer for the gospel. God told him that. That's what it was. You were going to suffer much for my sake. And it seems kind of a penance in a way that would happen, because here was Paul, who was formerly called Saul, who was beating Christians, who was putting them to death, who was persecuting them in a hard and harsh way. In fact, that's when he was encountered salvation, was when he was on his way with letters signed by the hierarchy back in Jerusalem to go grab all these folks. The chief priests had signed them and the scribes, and they were going to go haul them back, these Christians, back to Jerusalem and have their way with them. And so those are things. But also the self-inflicted hardships. And I mean, hard work includes the arduous task of insistent preaching and the toil of manual labor. I mean, sleepless nights means that the voluntary abstention from sleep. I mean, hunger probably would be voluntary fastings even that they went through as this was going on. Which brings us to a question that was sent in before we go on to the next verse. Why did Paul feel the need to commend himself? Well, that's a good question. And that was one that he was concerned with even as he was writing these things. I mean, the false teachers commended themselves, but only for personal gain. And we still see that happening in today's world when false teachers will commend themselves big time. But Paul wanted the Corinthians to know that not only had he bypassed personal gain, which they knew, but he had suffered in many ways in order to preach Christ. And by commending himself, Paul was devaluing the false teachers and reinforcing his own ministry and message among the Corinthians. And he commends us, friends, to others in our walk with God, but it isn't that it isn't in our personal strength or triumphs, but our weaknesses is where that comes through. And it's through the areas, those areas where we suffer and are adequate, that we exhibit our dependence on him, just as Paul did. And here Paul committed himself to them by mentioning his faithfulness in enduring persecution and citing his diligence in ministry labors to the point of extinguish deprivations when necessary. I mean, Paul then listed a few of the trials that he had endured because of the opposition of the people. I mean, he was beaten, he was put in prison, he faced angry mobs. These he experienced because he was faithful serving the Lord. And then he named some of the sacrifices he made voluntarily for the sake of the ministry. In stripes, imprisonments, tumults, in labors, sleepless, in fastings. And of course, Paul had not announced these things publicly. I mean, the only reason he mentioned them in this letter was to assure the Corinthians of his love for them. In fact, he didn't even allow them to help him in any way financially. He didn't want to be accused of that. Even though he had this offering going on, but the offering was not for him. He sat there and made his own living by making tents while he was amongst them, and then still would go out and preach. And so he made his own living so that he was not a burden on them. And so they knew that, and he calls a lot back on, you know the truth. You witnessed it. You saw it. All right, Let's go back. All right, verses 6 and 7. Again, he's continuing that list by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, the Holy Spirit, genuine love, by truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left. So Paul, again, commended himself positively by listing the important elements of the righteousness God had granted to him. And Paul lived and walked by the power of the Spirit. It was the central reason that all the other positive elements of his endurance were a reality. And from the mention of outward circumstances, Paul moves on to specify the inward qualities he sought to display and the spiritual equipment he relied on while discharging his apostolic commission. Purity in itself, that refers to the both moral uprightness and singleness of purpose. The word understanding, isn't simply pastoral insight, but it's also knowledge of the Christian faith and sensitivity to God's will. And by the word patient, Paul means the endurance of insult or injury without anger or retaliation. And this kindness word that he uses is the generous and sympathetic disposition that acts in love. Now, Paul's reference to the person of the Holy Spirit here emphasizes the Spirit as the source of all spiritual graces. That is, the Holy Spirit probably denotes the gifts and graces of the Holy Spirit, not coming from him, coming from the gift that comes through the Spirit. And after a reference to this proclamation of truth in the power of God, Paul introduces kind of a military metaphor that he had used earlier and would develop later, but weapons of righteousness, which means either the weapons supplied by God as a result of justification or the weapons that consist of personal integrity. But weapons in the right hand and in the left, that phrase may allude to the sword of the Spirit and to the shield of faith that form a part of the Christian's armor that we will see in several of the letters that we're going to be looking at further down the road in this study. And so that is something that could be, when I said off to the future, that's what that would be. Now, the scriptures are revealed, the revealed word of God. And during his entire ministry, Paul never operated beyond the boundaries of the direction and guidance of the divine revelation. And neither should you or I, my friend. Also, Paul didn't rely on his own strength when he ministered. Nor did Paul fight Satan's kingdom with human resources, but with spiritual virtue. I mean, Paul had both offensive tools, such as the sword of the Spirit, and defensive tools, such as the shield of faith or the helmet of salvation at his disposal. All right, now we're ready to look at verses 8 through 10, through honor and dishonor, through slander and praise. We are treated as imposters and yet are true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold, we live, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, and having nothing yet possessing everything. So behind these verses are probably actual allegations that Paul's opponents had made against him. I mean, in some quarters, Paul had probably become an object of disrepute and slander, but was thought of as a nobody. I mean, who relied on deceit or to become somebody. You know how that goes. An irresponsible person who needlessly, courting danger or death, or suffered his trouble, or an individual lacking the power that wealth affords, or the mark of ministry that has genuine character, which is paradoxical. And here Paul gave a series of paradoxes. Again, his service regarding his service for Christ, glory and dishonor, a bad report and good report, may epitomize the two types of response to Paul's preaching, or they may contrast the opinion of others, like dishonor or bad report, with the reward of God, you know, glory, good report. And the contrast that follows the paradoxical character of Paul's apostolic ministry is emphasized. In fact, this various charges have been made against him, and he takes the accusation, lets it stand, or invests it with his own meaning, and then supplies an imposing compliment to form a series of antitheses that point to the tension of living as a persecuted ambassador of Christ. And Paul's opponents in Corinth had accused him of being an imposter and a false apostle. I mean, In fact, the phrase here that we see is as known. I mean, this is a twofold reference. One to the fact that the Christians didn't know him before he began persecuting them. And second, his rejection by the community of leading Jews and Pharisees following his conversion. He had become known to his former world and well known and well loved by the Christian community. And this little phrase of making many rich, he's talking about spiritual wealth that Paul possessed and imparted it, did much to make his hearers spiritually wealthy as well. And then what a price Paul had to pay to be a faithful in his ministry. And yet, how little the Corinthians really appreciated all he did for them. I mean, they brought sorrow to his heart, and yet he was always rejoicing in Christ. He became poor, and they became, and that they might become rich. And the word translated poor means having the complete destitution of a beggar. Of a beggar. And Paul wasn't begging for praise, but he was reminding his friends in Corinth that his ministry to them had cost him dearly. And how different the lifestyle of a believer is to be formed than the one who has not received his grace. Instead of vainly pursuing happiness, riches, and power as the world does, and yet still finding no contentment, we're joyful, and we know we already possess these things through Christ. We can endure no matter what happens because God's presence gives us joy, friend. It energizes us and it empowers us for anything we must face. Verses 11 through 13 read, "We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted in your own affections. In return, I speak as to children. Widen your hearts also." So Paul proved his genuine love for the Corinthians by defining love's power. And this passage confirms the reality of his profession of love for them and for us, actually. And so Paul didn't customarily address his readers by name, doing so when his emotions had been deeply stirred at this, the bewitchment, if you will, of the Galatians, at the generosity of the Philippians, or here at the remarkable conduct of his defense and the intensity of his affection for the Corinthians. He could have done that so easily. But behind his freedom of speech was a warmly receptive attitude of heart. He continues, "If there are any feelings of constriction or restraint in our relationship, they're on your side, not mine. I appeal to you as my spiritual children. In fair exchange for my unrestricted affection, give me yours too." And so, although Paul's desire was for complete reciprocity in family and relationships, he was acutely aware of the affections that they could only be given and not taken. Now, why were they withholding their love? Well, because they had divided hearts. I mean, the false teachers had stolen their hearts, and now they were cold towards Paul. They were like a daughter engaged to be married, if you will, but being seduced by an unworthy suitor. I mean, the Corinthians were compromising with the world. And so Paul appealed to them to separate themselves to God. I mean, the way a faithful wife is separated to her husband. The evidence of Paul's genuine love for the Corinthians was that no matter how some of them had mistreated him, he still loved them and had room for them in his heart. Another question that was sent over. What had damaged the relationship between Paul and the Corinthians? Great, great question. Well, Paul had written a letter of criticism to the Corinthians. I mean, the sting of Paul's rebuke had opened the door for the false teachers to discredit Paul with some success. I mean, after some time had elapsed, the Corinthians had begun to see the legitimacy of Paul's rebuke, which praise be the Lord for that. All right, verses 14 through 16 read, "Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? Or what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God said, I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Well, let's get a little grammatical with this one. Note the nouns here that Paul uses in these verses. I mean, God desires his people. It's seen in these words. He wants to share with each other, which is a fellowship, and have in common, which was communion, if you will, the blessings of the Christian life. He wants to enjoy harmony and agreement as they live and work together. And when we try to walk with the world and with the Lord at the same time, we break this spiritual fellowship and create discord and division. Now, Paul has just appealed to the Corinthians for the mutual openness and affection and in speech. And in his own heart, he is wide open to them. But both he and they know why they can't reciprocate as fully as they ought to. I mean, some of them have an uneasy conscience about their continuing pagan associations. I mean, their apparent abruptness of verse 14, right after verse 13, may explain that by several things, actually, is a number first, maybe his, by this mutual knowledge. And second, by Paul's coming to the point immediately that he sets forth the truth plainly and speaks the truth in love. And then thirdly, perhaps by a brief dictation pause that he does with the pen. So it's possible here. I mean, Paul begins a concise summary of his message in this brief discretion, which repeats the main point of 1 Corinthians chapter 10, which is his warning to the Corinthians of the danger of idolatry. Flee from idolatry. Do not be yoked together with unbelievers, he says. And this isn't just an injunction against any and all association with unbelievers. It actually encouraged the Christian partner in a mixed marriage to maintain the relationship as encouraged as long as possible. Rather, this is against forming close attachments with non-Christians, using the agricultural metaphor about yoking. And although precisely what constituted a diverse yoke from the Corinthians remains unstated here in the text, but it clearly involved compromise with heathen. In other words, such as contrasting mixed marriages or initiating litigation before unbelievers in the cases involving believers that we saw him talk about in the first letter, or forming any relationship with unbelievers that would compromise Christian standards or jeopardize consistency of Christian witness. Paul's content to state a general principle that needs specific application under the Spirit's guidance. In five radical questions follow, in which each supposes a negative answer. They stress the incompatibility of Christianity and heathenism, and the clash of intimate relationships or fellowship between believers and unbelievers. And the two comparisons of abstract nouns, again, righteousness and light, and wickedness and darkness that we see there. And they follow two personal comparisons, Christ and the believer, and Belial, which is and the unbeliever. And Belial, by the way, is the ancient name for Satan, the utterly worthless one. And this contrasts sharply with Jesus Christ and the worthy one to whom believers are to be in fellowship with. And God tells us not to be found or bound to unbelievers because of their influence on our lives. Did he say we shouldn't love the lost? No, not at all. Did he tell us to treat them kindly? No, not really. Rather, he says we must be careful how we live. If the enemy gains a foothold in our lives by tempting us to compromise our faith and demonstrate our God's love and forgiveness, he'll make significant strides toward undermining our relationship with the Lord and our testimony for him. And so the important doctrine of separation here has been misunderstood and abused in recent years. And you hear it every single day when you turn on the news. But it is an essential truth. Some sincerely zealous Christians have turned separation into isolation until their fellowship has become so narrow that they can't even get along with themselves. And in reaction to this extreme position, our other believers have torn down the walls and will fellowship with anybody, regardless of what they believe or how they believe. And while we applaud their desire to practice Christian love, we want to remind them that even Christian love must exercise discernment. How true that is. The concept of not teaming up with unbelievers comes from Deuteronomy chapter 22 and verse 10. So it's nothing new. You shall not plow with an ox and a donkey together. The ox was a clean animal to the Israelites, but the donkey was not. And yet, it would be wrong to yoke them together. And furthermore, they have two opposite natures, the donkey and an ox, and they wouldn't even work well together out on the field. it would be cruel to bind them together. In the same way, it's wrong for believers to team up with unbelievers. God commands his people to come out, which implies a definite act on their part. Be separate suggests devotion to God for a special purpose. Separation isn't just a negative act of departure. It's also a positive act of dedication to God. We must separate from sin and onto God. We must become holy like him. The whole purpose that Christ came to this earth, my friend, is because we were separated from God. That's what sin does. But he loved and showed it in a far radical way. And that is to die for us, to take our punishment, our just punishment that was due us upon himself, that we might live. And that, my friends, is where we find our joy and our hope that the world does not see. And to be unequally yoked with the unbelievers of this world can cause an issue with our faith and it being used by the enemy to fire back. And so we've got to keep that in mind. God's command of separation is found throughout Scripture. It's nothing new. He warned Israel not to mingle with the pagan nations in the land of Canaan, yet they repeatedly disobeyed his word and were punished because of it. And the apostles in their letters to the churches also emphasize doctrinal and personal purity. But the believer was in the world, but he must be careful not to become like the world. And the church must also separate itself from those who reject the doctrine given by Christ and the apostles. Even in the book of Revelation, where the emphasis is on God's people being separated from that which is false and contrary to holy living, is very true. Question one of you sent over right here. How much can we associate with unbelievers? Great question. Awesome question. Now, Paul wasn't saying that Christians must avoid unbelievers. He's saying that Christians should avoid the kinds of associations that will cause us to adopt their values and patterns of life. And Jesus associated sinners in order to show God's love to them, but he influenced them rather than adopting their values. As Jesus's followers, we are to be salt and light in our world, revealing God's goodness and truth. I mean, temple of God, true Christianity, and idols, those idolatrous and demonic false religions, are utterly incompatible. Believers individually are spiritual houses in which the Spirit of Christ dwells. I mean, the chief reason why believers mustn't enter in a compromising relationship with unbelievers is that they belong exclusively to God. Corporately, they form the temple or sanctuary of the living God. And to establish this last point, Paul quotes or alludes to several Old Testament passages. Well, let's look at verses 17 and 18. Therefore, go out from their midst and separate from them, says the Lord, and do not touch unclean thing, no unclean thing. Then I will welcome you, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. Excuse me, sir. Okay. Well, Paul's next quotation here is from Isaiah chapter 52 in verse 11. And it stresses God's demand for purity of life and separation from evil. Isaiah, in Isaiah, the call was for separation or departure from Babylon, specifically with its pagan idolatry. And Paul, the call is for separation from unbelievers with their pagan way of life. I mean, this verse may not be used to defend separation from believers on the grounds of doctrinal differences. That's not what he's talking about. But I will receive you. This phrase stems from Ezekiel in chapter 20, in a couple of places there. And God's acceptance and approval of his people is dependent on their obedience to his commands. Separation from the world leads to fellowship with God. That's the bottom line. It's not only the irrational and sacrilegious, but disobedient to be found together with unbelievers. When believers were saved, we were to disengage ourselves from all forms of false religion and make a clean break from all sinful habits and old idolatrous patterns, and to be as Christ was, holy. The next mosaic of the Old Testament text comes from 2 Samuel chapter 7, with the reference to daughters coming from Israel, or coming from Isaiah 40, chapter 43, verse 6. What God promised to Solomon through David and to Israel through Solomon finds its fulfillment in what God is to the community of believers through Christ. If Christians corporately are the temple of the living God, individually, they are sons and daughters. As a result of separating themselves from false doctrine and practice, believers will know the full richness of what it means to be children of God. When God becomes our Father, when we trust Jesus Christ as our Savior, but he can't be to us a Father unless we obey him and fellowship with him. He longs, my friends, to receive us in love and treat us as his precious sons and daughters. Salvation means we share the Father's life, but separation means that we will enter fully into the Father's love. Well, my friends, that's a tough lesson we had to learn there. And that is, there's so much truth in what we have seen here in regards to how we are to be with the world today, how we are to separate ourselves from those false teachings that are being taught in the world. Might be another reason why we're seeing such an uptick on homeschooling, as Christian parents are beginning to see what's happening in the schools and such. So those are important things as we take a look at it. But we need to remember God wants us to become pure like him as he continues to transition us and transform us into his image to become more and more like him. And the day is coming very soon, and what he is going to call all genuine believers to himself in the clouds. And so the question is, are you ready for that? Or have you been already pulled back into the world? In which, as we learned today, that means you weren't genuine in the first place. You never were a genuine believer. And so that's important for us to think about and pray about in our own lives. And so, my friend, if you have come to know the Christ, please let us know at rbgf22@yahoo.com. But if you still have questions, and if God is really stirring your heart right now, that's a great thing, because that means he's working to reveal truth to you. And so feel free to shoot over those questions that you might have as well at rbgf22@yahoo.com. Next week, we're going to be taking a look at chapter 7, the 16 verses that are there. So if you get a chance to take a look at those in advance, please do that. And again, if you have questions, feel free to fire them over. You guys have been pretty good at that so far, sending those over, and we can try and answer those in the course of our lesson for you. So please send those again, rbgf22@yahoo.com on those. It's important that you do go ahead and utilize that email as well. As I mentioned and referred to earlier, Redeemed by Grace Fellowship is not meant to be a replacement or a substitute for the local church. Christ created the church for a specific reason, and that specific reason is for us to be to serve under him. And so that's an important thing. There is a lot of reasons, actually, he created that church, but that is one of the main ones. And so if you have not been part of a local church, my friend, I so strongly encourage you to be a part of such. And part of that is for uplifting and you hearing truth that you might continue to walk in the counsel of the Lord and be held accountable as well. And so as we move away from the things of the world and into the things of God, we need that. We need that safety net, if you will. Please, if you don't know what to be looking for in a church from a biblical standard, please send over the email. Again, rbgf22@yahoo.com, and we'll be glad to send you some information about what type of things you need to consider and prayerfully consider from a biblical standpoint in that. And in fact, you let me know what town you live in, I'll send you a couple of things that I might be able to find out there. You'll have to go out there and check them out and to see if they match that criteria for you as well. But anyway, it's important that you do that. Please, though, if you continue to be part of this fellowship as we continue to learn more about God and the things that he wants us to do, and to fellowship and tell others about it. You know the situation in the world today, and for them to hear the truth is so important because the clock is ticking. And so please make sure that you do hit all our platforms. And as we talked about earlier, hit that thumbs up, hit the subscribe to all those so that you get the content that you can forward on as well to everyone you know. So please help us do that. And in fact, if you think you'd like to be part of this ministry, rbgf22@yahoo.com, send us over an email. I don't know, maybe you are a singer, maybe you like to teach, maybe you like, you feel led to work with kids or youth, or maybe you're a lady that likes to work in women's ministries. Maybe you're a technology guru that can help us behind the scenes with improving what we put out there and things along that age. Whatever it might be, rbgf22@yahoo.com. We'll be glad to talk with you and pray with you to see if that's where God's leading you. So feel free to do that as well. Check out some of our other studies. Again, you'll find all of these on YouTube, and you will find them on Rumble as well. Some of the audio you will find out on Spotify. And again, we are looking at some other podcasts that we could go to put these on. So you might see those appearing before we formally announce that it's there. But check us out. Obviously, the Pauline epistles we're going through now, there is a complete study on the Gospel of John out there. Please go through that as well. Our very first study was a walk through the book of Acts, which we utilize that study a little bit as we set up some of the Pauline epistles, because they specifically had the historical record about what happened when that church was being planted and what was going on. So we utilize that in our introductions to each of these letters. So, but go check it out. And while we were doing the walk through the book of Acts, what have you sent over a request for a future study? And in fact, if you have one, send it over, rbgf22@yahoo.com. But that request was, do you have anything on the basics of Christianity? Well, there's the fundamentalist faith. If you haven't been through the fundamentals of the faith, my friends, you need to do it. You need to go through that. It is so powerful. There's not a better course that I've ever gone through on fundamentals of the faith, or the basics of Christianity, than that there right there. Go check it out. Go check it out and go through it. If you have any questions as you're working through any of these older lessons, please let us know. We'll be glad. In fact, when you send that email or questions, make sure we know which study you're talking about, type of thing. So, yeah, I do that. And if you have kids or grandkids, we do have one that's been going on now for about 2 years. It is produced by Sermons for Kids. It is an awesome little sermonette that we get each and every week. That's you know, usually about 10-15 minutes long, and it's a chance for them to learn a lot about Jesus, but also have some fun. And so we are going to spend some time with them. We're going to make sure that they hear the Word of God read. We're going to make sure that they learn about the importance of sharing Jesus as well. And it gives you a good opportunity. We had a father one time send us an email, say, hey, I've been trying to figure out how to do an in-home family devotional, and I'm not sure how to make that work. I'm not sure where to find a good material for that, this, that, and the other thing, but I saw this video, and if it's okay with you, can we use that in our family devotionals? And absolutely. In fact, what he's doing is we dropped usually at the beginning of the week that on most weeks. And so he would get it in the beginning of the week and wash through it and write down the scripture that we're talking about. He'd go look at his scripture and study. And then at the end of the week, he'd have that family devotional. I believe he told me it was Friday nights. And so that whole night was that they had ordered pizza in. They watched the video together, his wife and kids, and then when it was done, he would then begin to have a discussion with them from what he learned about the same material. So he just tacked on to it, and it gave him a place to start. And fantastic, absolutely. Praise the Lord for that. And he's using it. We've had emails also saying that they have now chosen to bring their children out of the public school and homeschooling and are utilizing this as part of their curriculum. Fantastic. Feel free to do that. So we applaud you for making that stand in Christ. Absolutely. So I hope you've enjoyed our lesson this week. And before we depart, let's go ahead and close in prayer, and then we'll close out after that with listening again to In Christ Alone. So let's pray together. Almighty God, we just thank you again for the word you've given us today. Lord, we pray that you would open our minds and hearts to understand it, to believe it, help our unbelief, Lord, and help us understand what it is you have called us to do and to be. We pray, Lord, that you would continue to transform us into your likeness, that you would indeed work us toward holiness and remove sin from our lives, Lord, that we might not only confess it to you when it's happened, but that we would genuinely repent of it and turn back to you for strength and power to defeat it. And so we thank you for that, Lord. I pray for the fellowship that you would bless them this week as they go through lives and they think about the things in this world and they see those situations in life where they see the conflict, as you talked about through Paul today, and that we might be able to say that's what God was trying to say through Paul. And I see it. And Lord, give me strength right now to do that. It doesn't mean I defriend somebody, but it does mean that I associate with them less, that I'm not put into temptation and harm's way, but that I might be light to them and love them and share with them the truth. And so we just thank you for that. Lord, again, just continue to bless Redeemed by Grace Fellowship. Help us to grow, to reach more people for your sake. For this is all of you and none of us. We thank you. We praise you. We love you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Know that we love you as well. So you guys have a great week, and we will see you next week. And here is In Christ Alone. Christ Alone.